Okay, good evening. Thank you for joining us for this panel on social exclusion today, where we are discussing about the rights of the transgender community across India and what does it mean for them during the time of a pandemic and lockdown. On the panel today, we are very excited actually to have Dr. Ejaz Ahmed from Kashmir. He is an LGBTQIA activist and the founder and chairperson of Sonzal Welfare Trust that works exclusively for the well-being of gender and sexual minorities in the region. Welcome, Dr. Ejaz.
Thank you.
Our next panelist is Grace Banu, who I think many people know about. Grace is a Dalit transgender activist and writer from Tamil Nadu. She's actively involved in relief work for transgender communities in rural and urban Tamil Nadu. Welcome, Grace.
Thank you. Hi.
Also on the panel is Kiruba Munuswamy, who's an advocate practicing in the Supreme Court of India and the founder of the Legal Initiative for Equality. She's a judicial activist striving for social justice and equality. Hi, Kiruba. Welcome.
Hello, everyone.
Thanks for joining us. And lastly, we have Sinduja Parthasarthi, an award-winning humanitarian photojournalist and also a good friend based out of Chennai. The core of her work explores gender equity, indigenous human rights issues, and environmental sustainability issues. Hi, Sindhu. Thanks for joining us today. Sindhu will be co-moderating this panel along with us today. And I'm very glad that we are having this conversation from different parts, you know, from people with people from different parts of the country, and parts where we are usually not aware what's going on. Dr. Ejaz, why don't you tell us a little bit about the work that you've been doing in Kashmir, and give us some insight into the scenario there currently. Of course, we all know that Kashmir has been under a lockdown for a while now. It's not just the lockdown that's happening right now. But it would be good for our audience to hear from you about the scenario there. Could you share with us?
Yeah, sure. Gentle ladies, gentlemen, and the people who identify beyond the heteronormative dichotomy of male and female, masculine and feminine, a very good evening to all of you. I'm Dr. Ejaz, and I'm founder of Sonzal Welfare Trust, and Sonzal exclusively works for the well-being of gender and sexual minorities, LGBTQIA community in Kashmir. We know that Kashmir has been witnessing armed conflict for almost 3 decades now. And, imagine knowing at a young age you are different. Imagine seeing these differences contrasted every day in the relationships you grow up around. Imagine your peers hurl insults defining how you are different. Imagine the institutions of the society not recognizing your differences. Imagine your own parents, disowning you and considering you an abomination. And also imagine you being bullied to the extent that you have to drop out from the school, which renders you ineligible for the white collar jobs. And imagine you applying for the PT jobs and you are not in a position to, you are violated. You are violated in the most intimate ways. You are violated physically. You are violated emotionally, sexually. And you imagine you growing old. You don't have the support of the family. You don't have the near ones around you. Without social security, without the accessibility to the basic resources. This is exactly the life of a transgender in Kashmir. And now imagine this person who is, considered as a social outcast, and the person is, living in a lockdown. Mm-hmm. This lockdown, we have been witnessing the lockdowns of different sorts here in Kashmir. We know, like, we witnessed the, you know, curfew for months at a stretch, and it directly affects the people who are at the margins. And we know that transgender community, they don't have the accessibility to the quality education, they don't have accessibility to, you know, quality healthcare, they don't have accessibility to various services as well. Mm. And it completely pushes them to the wall. Unlike the transgender community in other parts of the India, they have a sort of visibility. You see the trans people in, you know, you see them at these street lights, you know, begging. You see them, you know, going for toli badai. But here you see this community is completely invisible. Hmm. Because of so many socio-cultural, you know, these barriers. Anyone who identifies as a transgender in Kashmir, the person is deprived of various, you know, various social, political, and personal, you know, opportunities and the resources where the person can exercise the citizenship rights and live a life with worth and dignity. This is the life of a transgender in Kashmir.
Right. Yeah. And can you tell us a little bit about the work that you are doing with the Sonzal Welfare Trust, and when that began, and what was the background towards starting this trust? If you can just quickly share a little bit about it.
It started in, I guess, 2009 or 10, when one of the trans community members, most of the transgender community members, they are that associated with the matchmaking here in Kashmir. And one day, one trans community member, she happened to visit our home, but my mother was very reluctant in receiving the guest. Hmm. And somehow I intervened. I was too young to understand these things. And somehow I intervened and she let the person come in. And once the person left, she washed the cup twice, citing the reason that it became profane. Hmm. That was a turning point in my life. Then I decided that I should do something. And in 2010, I started my master's in social work. And the same year, I started working for the transgender community in Chile. I approached the social welfare department, and somehow I convinced them to formulate an intervention plan. They formulated a very good intervention plan to begin with, but they couldn't implement it, citing the reason that it is a policy decision and it requires a nod from the cabinet. And, you know, it just stretched for almost two years. And then I moved the case to the State Human Rights Commission. And ultimately, for almost 4 years, nothing absolute came out, nothing concrete was coming out. And then I moved a public interest litigation in High Court in 2017. And the case is still going on. You know, meanwhile, I realized that this movement, it cannot remain confined to only transgenders. It has to be inclusive. Mm. And I started talking about the LGBT community as well. Mm. And the movement became inclusive, but there are so many challenges. I mean, it's not easy to work in Kashmir. We are providing psychosocial care for the LGBT community. And this is basically a grassroots initiative where we are trying to provide a safe space, because here in Kashmir we don't have safe space for the LGBT people. So we are providing the non-judgmental zone where they can actually vent out their feelings and they can have a, you know, sense of community and belongingness. That was actually the reason the Sonzal came into existence. And from advocacy, it then started working at the grassroots level. It started working with the community. We have this ASH as one of the projects that exclusively caters the mental health needs of this community. And then we have this sexual health clinic. We have a network of these professionals, clinical psychologists. We have counselors. We have social workers who are providing the services to this community.
That's wonderful. Yeah. That's wonderful to know that at least you have a network, even if it is small, but there is a network that is looking after the issues and the needs of a certain community. I think Sindhuja is back, and I'm let her kind of take this conversation forward from here.
Thanks, Ji. I do not know if I missed this. I just, did you speak about the book? He also wrote a book about hijras in Kashmir in 2017, which was an ethnographic study. And I think that kind of pushed the government to look at the state of transgender people there more seriously, and there were a few changes that came about. So if you can share that, I just, that'll be great.
While I started working with the community, I realized that there has been no work which was done for this community, especially the academic work was completely missing. There was a missing link. I tried to reach out to various sources. I tried to investigate into this, the issues of the transgender very scientifically, but I was not able to get any kind of the resource because, I mean, academia, the intellectual group, they have completely ignored them. And then I started working on the book in 2011, and it came in 2017, and it kind of, like, there was already a case which was in the High Court. It pushed the government to at least think about the community, to formulate a draft policy for the community, though there were many loopholes in the draft policy which later on we objected to, but at least there was a discourse which initiated there was a series of events. Like, we also conducted various programs with the government officials. We tried to sensitize them, and this book was one of the milestones which actually it forced the government to formulate an intervention plan.
Yeah, thanks. I think I've read the book, and I think that's very, very interesting and very in-depth stories of people there. And I remember when I met you and I was in Kashmir documenting the lives of some of the transgender people there, we spoke about the unique identity of Kashmir transgender people. One, that of being a Kashmiri. Two, the religious identity. And three, of course, the struggle of gender identity itself, which is common across the country. And these three, the intersection of these three makes it a very, very unique identity bit. And if you can speak about that, and also about how conflict has influenced and impacted their lives.
Definitely, like, conflict in Kashmir is like an elephant in the room, and we cannot just ignore this conflict. And it is the lived reality of the people here. You know, the Kashmiri identity, it overtakes the transgender identity. We have the transgender identity, then we have Kashmiri Muslim identity, and then we have the Kashmiri identity. There is a lot of, like, intersection, then intersectionality, which influences the transgender identity. So, and this conflict, it is not only affecting their daily lives, but it is also, it is basically cutting across the various experiences. Like, being a transgender in the Kashmir, it is very difficult. You cannot cross dress here openly. Like, there is a lot of, like, social pressure and other things, other barriers, but this identity, the Kashmiri identity, it overtakes. Like, we recently had this abrogation of Article 370, and it affected the trans people as well. It affects the LGBT people as well. But and you might be knowing that how it was hijacked by the various so-called LGBT activists in India as well, who claim that this is the gay liberation for the LGBT people. But in actuality, what happens, like, once we talk about the identity formation of LGBT people and vis-a-vis Kashmir, so this Kashmiri identity, it is of prime importance for them. Kashmiri identity, I mean, they're not going to compromise on the Kashmiri identity. And then Muslim identity, it has an impact on them. And then is the transgender identity. And if you just try to flip it over, you see the transgender identity is supreme. And these two identities, the being a Kashmiri Muslim, it affects them. So it is a very complex thing that is very difficult to put it in the words.
Right.
And, you know, talking about the current situation and all of this, is social distancing possible? And I remember also about how in Kashmir, finding graveyards for transgender people is very tough. There is nobody to nobody who can pay for buying the land for this. And if the community, you know, contracts it, God forbid, and if they're dead, I think the healthcare system is ready to support them.
See, Sindhu, though, you know, we know that the livelihood of transgender people, it entirely depends on the interaction with the people, and the social distancing has cut off the transgender community from all the interactions. You know, due to the lockdown, the transgender community who rely on matchmaking, predominantly on matchmaking and, you know, performance in the marriage ceremonies or the sex work, they are not able to, you know, have these interactions, and it is directly affecting their livelihood. And after the 6 months of curfew and now this lockdown, it has affected them. They don't have accessibility to the quality healthcare, and they don't have accessibility to the various resources. Even if, God forbid, some untoward thing happens to them, I believe like they may not be in a position to access these services. Because, I mean, even if we talk about, you know, just 2 or 3 days before, we had a trans woman who was ailing, and it took us almost 3-4 hours to shift her to the hospital. I mean, government is not actually responding to the needs of this community, and they are vulnerable because, I mean, if we will just try to analyze their daily life, the substandard life that they are living, you see, like, they don't have the stomach full of the meals. And how come is it possible that they will have the immunity that makes them more susceptible to these ailments? And there's a possibility, like, the kind of life that they are living, they don't have shelter, they don't have it is the social distancing, it is a privilege, it is a class privilege, and unfortunately transgender community, for them it's not a privilege because they cannot maintain the social distance. I mean, there are people who are in the ghettos, 5-6 people living in a small room, and they have to come out by hook or crook to at least keep the pot boiling. I mean, it's very difficult for them.
I was just wondering if Grace can come in and if she can share some of the activities that she has been involved with as an activist, a little bit about herself as well.
Hi. Thank you so much. Hi, yes. Here, the after, so we are doing, I'm a founder director of Trans Rights Now Collective. So Trans Rights Now Collective, we are doing empower the trans people in the especially education, employment field. So we did lot of people who are in the police department, and we put some trans people there. We are trying some people to write a government examination, and we give the training to the how to write the government examination. And if any struggle it's happened, so we are filing the case in the Madras High Court, and we got a lot of positive judgment, and our fight is we want separate reservation for the trans community, and that case is also going on Supreme Court and the Madras High Court also. And we did a lot of relief work. Last time that cyclone happened, Kaja cyclone, so that time also we did. And the Chennai issue happened also, that we did the relief work. And now I came here for visiting. I'm in Tuticorin district. In Tamil Nadu, Tuticorin district, it's a completely South Tamil Nadu. And I came here because of here, so rural area in Tuticorin district. I'm in Kovilpatti. So Kovilpatti, here we have more than 150 trans people. They are all doing baking, and some people are doing the folk artist thing. And I coordinate with this district collector, and we organize to provide this trans people to free home and land. Mm-hmm. So that housing project is going on. So I came here to visit that housing construction project, and now I'm stuck in the after this 144 happened. So I stuck in this village. So from here, I when the government announced the 144, immediately, so 1 or 2 days, the lot of people, they are have some monies and they manage themselves. But after 3 days, I got lot of calls from the rural areas. So Thoothukudi to Kovilpatti, it's around 30 kilometer, more than 30 kilometer. And after Kovilpatti also, lot of villages are there. So I got a call from the village trans people. I don't have money. I don't know how to manage, and I don't have a food. I don't have a rice. So this kind of calls I got. So immediately I say I thought, okay, we'll talk to somebody. So I suddenly called to Sindhu, and I know some people. So because I don't know that fluent English writing and the speak. So okay, I approach some people, and some people suggest me you can raise the crowdfunding source. So I put the Milab, and that crowdfunding it's already we raised. We raised for 150 people, but we supported 200 people, and now collected the another folk artists also there. Say, in basically rural area people, they can't go to the sex work because they don't have the space to do the sex work, and they are like most of the people are doing baking, and some people are doing folk dance. Like here, lot of temples are there, and in that temples, this is the festival time. So this 3 month, March, April, May, this 3 month only the festival time. In this 3 month, they are earning lot of some money to sustain the whole year. So this 3 month is they are completely stuck. So they don't have any resources. So immediately raised the crowdfunding for this trans folk artist. So now that is also finished. So relief work is also going on. That folk artist relief work.
That's great, Grace. But other than the relief work that you're managing so well, who is educating the community and the people in the rural areas? Do you see that there are government initiatives or people from the government going and educating these communities? Or is it nonprofits like yourself who are explaining to them what this pandemic is? Why is there a lockdown? How do they protect
them? Nobody. No. See, the thing is, for example, Thoothukudi district collector, they are doing that awareness programs. Awareness means they put one, I think I saw one car, and they put the speaker, and they continuously announce, stay in the home. That's it. And they can't enter into the village. I said they are surrounding in the that main road. So village means that colony area is there, and that how do we say the mele teru kile teru la irukum. So they are going only the mele teru areas, and the kile teru that main road only they are playing this voice record. And especially trans people, they can't do anything, and they can't educate how to this trans people, because we are living in in this for example, the Kovilpatti, we have 10 families, 10 houses, each and every houses have 10 to 15 family members. So right now I'm in one of houses. This house, we have 15 people, and this is only for one, how do I say? It's a single bedroom house. So how do we manage that social distance here?
True.
They don't know how to do the social distancing. So for example, I got a call from Virudhunagar district, nearby Virudhunagar district. From here to one village is there, it will take around 45 kilometer. Okay, so I got a call from that village transhuman. I don't have anything. My family, we are in the 15 family members. We don't have any ration, anything. So I said, no, okay, ma, do you have ration card or any ID proof? They have only Aadhaar card. And do you have bank account? They said, no, I don't have any bank account. And nobody have bank account. And from that village to, if they have bank account, that village to main area, it will take around, already I said, na. So for 15 to 20 kilometers, they don't have vehicle also. So they should come to take a money from the ATM. And that village, they don't have a ATM places near. And they said, they talked to me. So immediately I said, okay, I got some groceries and some vegetables. I have a bike. Our team have a bike. So immediately we... two people, we went in their village, but the lot of police people, they stopped me and they said, why you are came here? You are in the Thoothukudi district. This is Virudhunagar district. You people are doing sex work. This time also you don't do any, how do I say? Vaaya mudittu veetla summa irukka mudiyada. Avanga police vandu open ave sonnanga. Unga idha mudittu neengala veetukulla irukka maatingala. இப்படிலாம் வெளியில சுத்திட்டு இருக்கிறீங்க, எதுக்கு வாரீங்க? இப்ப கூட உங்களுக்கு எல்லாம் அரிப்படுத்து போய் அலையறீங்களா? இப்படியே என்கிட்ட கேட்ட கேள்வி கேட்டாங்க.
சிந்து, could you just translate that for our audience?
May not be word to word, but yeah, I think the police was pretty aggressive in the way they stopped them, and they're saying, how can you guys come out at this point in time? Can you just sit at home and do your business?
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
And also in between, Chris Banu mentioned about Mela Teru and Keela Teru. Mela Teru is basically the West Street where dominant caste groups live. Okay. And Keela Teru is actually the street that is segregated only for Dalits. And Dalits are not supposed to cross this Keela Teru. Yeah.
Okay. And it's great that, Kiruba, that you've come in and you've mentioned, about this. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the work that you have been doing, and then we will ask questions that have come in from the audience. Just before you start, Kiruba, I would like to inform everybody who's present on the panel today that you feel free to ask your questions in the Q&A box, which is at the bottom. We will start asking questions shortly. Yeah, Kiruba, tell us a little bit about your work.
So I have been practicing law from 2008, and in 2014, I moved to the Supreme Court. And the very reason why I wanted to elevate my practice to the Supreme Court was two important landmark cases in the Madras High Court that I won. And the first case was Nangai case. Though I have been fighting for the rights of Dalits and against caste atrocities here in Tamil Nadu, honestly speaking, that was the first case that was relating to a trans community that I fought in the courtroom. Otherwise, we used to go to police stations and supporting them on other means, but legally fighting, that was the first case. So that was a case where the girl was an intersex and she was brought up as a woman and she was feeling herself as a woman. But still, when she applied for this police woman constable post, she was recruited to the post. And when she was undergoing this usual physical training, it is a mandate that they should undergo a medical examination. And the doctor who examined her, she didn't even had an idea about what intersex is and what transgender means. So she simply made a note that the person is a transgender person, but actually she was an intersex. So based on this one particular note, she was given notice and she was dismissed from the post. And she had tried hard for a year or so. And she had even approached many retired judges who have told there is no law in this nation to protect your rights. So you better wait for something to come up. And they have referred to this NALSA case, and they have told the cases at the final hearing, and she could wait for quite some time. But then I was referred about this case, and I was referred by an anti-caste group from Chidambaram. And when I went through the papers, I was very sure that the trans community, they didn't have to wait for any special law, but the fundamental rights that was protecting and that is guaranteeing our fundamental rights very much applies to the trans community as well. So as in when you interpret all the fundamental rights and any other anti-discrimination or any special protective laws should obviously apply for the trans community. So we filed the petition based only on the right to equality and right against discrimination on the basis of gender. And the case was quite a very difficult one. The judge was very reluctant in hearing my arguments because I was a junior. I was even small when I did this case in 2014. So the judge was actually appointing every senior counsel present in the room to be the amicus curiae in the matter to assist the courtroom, but he didn't listen to me. But somehow I fought for the case for over 8 to 9 months and finally we won. And after I win this case and after the case was published in the newspapers, the second case came to me. And she is from Tiruchi and she is also feeling herself as a woman and she has every document as a woman. But when she applied for this woman constable post, like the first case, she was also dismissed. But the difference between the first case and the second case was that in the first case, the girl was belonging to a dominant caste, so that she was treated in a better manner and she was given show cause notice, she was given an opportunity to be heard, and then she was dismissed. And because of that reason, we were able to get back wages for her. Even we were able to get consequences, seniority and everything. But in the second case, the girl belonged to a manual scavenging community. Mm-hmm. And instead of giving any show cause notice, her parents were called to the police training center and they have been locked up in a room for 48 hours and they were threatened with pressing of criminal charges. And then as a matter of fact, she was forced to resign from the police constable post. So I was able to realize even in the differential treatment of trans community or any intersex person, there is a vital role that caste plays. So that's the point when I realized that there is a need to talk about caste-based discrimination even in the trans community. And by the time there was no understanding of intersex, so legally speaking, we didn't want to interfere into the definition or interpretation of whether they are transgender or whether they are intersex. But we wanted to get the benefit from the note that was very much a ground for dismissal. And after these two cases, I realized there are so many laws that protect transgender persons even before the NALSA judgment. And because I was a junior, I was not able to do my fullest best service to the community. So I wanted to push myself into an environment where I could get some exposure and where I'll be recognized for the work I'm doing. And actually it worked. And after moving to the Supreme Court, though I was not able to go to police station and I was not able to fight cases in the Madras High Court, I was helping the community with consultations over phone. And I'm still active in the anti-caste groups and in the discussions of trans and LGBTQI community based rights. And I basically think the legal fraternity has actually failed the trans community when it comes to their exclusive trans rights. Because when I filed the case, there was no NALSA judgment, when there was no trans protection rights law or any exclusive act. But I think it depends on the interpretation that the judiciary makes. So if you have the broad-mindedness and if you are actually setting aside all your prejudices and biases against the trans community or LGBTQI community, any person should have the rationality to, in fact, interpret any protective law in favor of LGBTQI community. So that's when I realized that sensitizing the community with any fundamental right is important. And also I have been already educating the Dalit communities with all the protective laws and legal awareness campaigns. So to club both of them together and to have a banner to do our work, I started this legal initiative for equality. Otherwise, I have been doing it for almost 8 years without any banner. And also this pro bono cases for trans community is actually very difficult. For instance, you asked Grace Bano about the state support. In fact, even in the matter of the sexual offenses against women or the well-recognized heterosexual cis women, we don't have any state support. Then how can we expect that kind of support to be extended to the trans community, right? So however, we are referring to some NGO who would come forward to help the community like Banus and other organizations. So bringing awareness is one thing, and fighting against the state is another thing, and sustaining the surviving through this lockdown is the third thing. And I would like to lastly mention one quick information that started during the lockdown. In Amirpet, there was a poster pasted on every metro wall stating not to allow any hijra person or transgender person into any shop, because they not only spread AIDS, but they will also steal all your money, and they are actually very threatening than the corona. So this poster was printed in Telugu and posted on every metro wall in Amirpet in Telangana. So many were posting this poster on Twitter and so Facebook and other social media accounts. So I took it into account, and we raised a complaint with the Amirpet police and Telangana Hyderabad city police, and the issue was taken into notice, and I think they have taken some action against the person who pasted it, and the poster was immediately removed from Amirpet. So
for Dalits, the stigma continues.
Yes, continues.
Right.
Not only against Dalit community, but especially against trans community, for the reason that they involve in sex work.
Correct. Okay. Sindhu, I'll let you come in because we couldn't speak with you and you didn't get a chance to share your work earlier. And once maybe we've done that, I will start picking up some of the questions that we have.
Sure. Prop, then I'll just run through some of the pictures that I have.
Sure.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Yes. So I just was just speaking about the situation in Kashmir, and these are some of my pictures that I shot there.
Yeah.
This is Reshma, who is one of the most famous singers and matchmakers there in Srinagar. She was one of those people who started out right in the beginning. So if you go on YouTube, you'll see a lot of followers for her. So they generally dance in the mehendi ceremonies and the wedding ceremonies, and this is pretty much what they do for their livelihood, right? But this is again, when they're in the 20s and 30s is when they're able to do this. You see here a picture of somebody called Nisar, who's a senior trans person. And even when I met her last year, was living in a very old, crumpled house, one-room house, and was saying, I do not even know if I will get a space to die, if I'll get a graveyard to die, and if people will even find my dead body if there is. The access to healthcare system is one of the biggest challenges. And in the context of corona, I think none of the isolation wards, none of these hospitals have transgender ward. There is only male and female ward. So there is a lot of fear about whether they will get, whether the already existing stigma and discrimination will affect them there. And like in various other parts of the country, I think they also, most of them do not live with their families and live in, with their community. This is a picture of one of them who is able to live with the family. The family has accepted Shafiq, and she lives with her parents and sisters and her niece. She involves herself in also doing art and craft work of paper mesh, which is famous in Kashmir. I wanted to ask you about the hospital in Srinagar and in Kashmir. Are there separate wards for transgenders? And is this lack of availability of health healthcare, also stopping some people from getting tested?
Absolutely, yes, Sindhu. It is very unfortunate that we don't have these separate wards for the transgender people. And even if we try to analyze, we see that, you know, the medical fraternity, both the doctors as well as the paramedics, they are not sensitive enough to deal with the transgender people. Last time when we shifted that abandoned trans person from the road to the hospital, the doctor was very reluctant in touching the body of that trans person. So you can understand that there is a lot of stigma, a lot of prejudice, a lot of like misinformation, even in the medical fraternity. And I don't know like when they will have these inclusive, gender inclusive health policies. I mean, I'm just hopeful, but I don't actually see things actually happening. You know, if something happens this time, I'm damn sure like they may be forced to, you know, they may be forced in these wards with either man or the woman.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for sharing, Ajaz. So from Kashmir, I also wanted to show some of the pictures from Manipur. And you see here Santa Kurai, who's a famous activist in this region. And he, again, is a pioneer of sorts. She runs this Manipur Nupi Manbi Association there, which works towards the rights of the transgender community. She's one of those people who started the culture of beauty parlors in Manipur, which is one of the biggest ways to earn a living there. She started something called San Gen Beauty Parlor, and there are about 40 of them right now, and all of them in the lockdown are back at home, have no means of living. And of course, some of them have been able to access... Not all of them. So you also, another occupation is farming, and again, they're all in the lockdown. Manipur is also one of those places where the transgender community has started doing a lot of design work and tailoring. That's another area of work there. This is a picture of one of those famous designers, Kalu, whose work has been showcased across the world. But I think the other aspect of the challenges for transgender community, again, across India, is mental health. So you see here a picture of Bopu Kagan, who came out as a transgender long back, participated in beauty pageants in Manipur, and was doing really well till an underground group got together and beat her up and humiliated in public, shaved her head and put her through a lot of pain. And since then, she resorted to alcohol. So just reading this research by the Institute of Medical Science in Manipur, which says 60% of them of the people in transgender community use alcohol, and another 43% of them use psychotropic and non-psychotropic drugs. And again, across India, the usage of tobacco is really high in the community, and all of them makes them more susceptible or vulnerable to contracting the virus also. Right? And like Banu was saying, I think social distancing is a big challenge, is a pipe dream for the community.
Yeah, and it's also quite, it's a concept more for the privileged classes as we are observing. I'm going to pick up an interesting question that I see from Gayatri. Gayatri asks, what are the commonalities, be it legal, artistic or sociocultural, and what are the differences working in Kashmir versus Tamil Nadu? For artists or activists working in geographically distant spaces, are there benefits like cross-learning, and are there possibilities for collaboration? Sindhu, do you want to take that? Maybe you or anybody else can take that up.
Sure. I think the commonality is the first thing that comes to me. The social discrimination, the living on the margins, and the kind of ridicule they faced growing up in schools. And I think Banu has gone through a lot, and she'll probably add there. And the fight they have to the kind of struggle they have to go through to get even the basic minimum. Banu, by the way, is the first transgender engineer in India, and I know she had to go through a lot of struggle to be able to study, right? So I think that's one commonality. Mental health issues and high rate of suicide is another. And another beautiful thing across is I think the spirit of community, community being together and supporting each other is beautiful in transgender community. All of them live together. Kashmir, of course, does not have the Guru Gharana. Manipur does not have the Guru Gharana system. But yeah, I think they live together. They support each other, especially in difficult times. But I'll let Banu and Ejaz also
share with us. Banu? Hi.
Yes.
So can you share like what could be certain things that, let's say, the community and artists from the community, whether they are in Kashmir or Manipur or Tamil Nadu or wherever, how do you think there are possibilities where they could learn from each other and they can collaborate with each other?
Yes. In Kashmir, I think everywhere we are fighting for our rights, right. But in Kashmir it's completely different. See, they are every day they are facing so many problems. You know, so I read a lot of news about the Kashmir, and but here Tamil Nadu we are also struggling a lot to get our rights. But here also folk artists, all the people are there. And the common thing is, I want to share another one. Trans community, within our trans community, we have HIV infected trans. And sugar patient, diabetes patients. So those patients also there, and we have elder trans people. And we have to manage their medicine also. So not for food and regular things. We have to manage to get their medicine. It's very hard to get the medicine. You know, for example, HIV infected trans, one HIV infected trans, she called me. She said, I don't have a tablet. I want to get tablet immediately. But I called to immediately that helpline and the district collectorate. They said, you can go directly and get the tablet in the GH, government hospital. See, the thing is, HIV infected trans already, their immunity is very low. So how they go to the outside? And we have to give the tablet door delivery. Some people, for safety purpose, some people have, in Tamil Nadu, what they are doing, each and every district have the ART center. That ART center in the district headquarters only. So if I want to get the tablet, I want to go to Kovilpatti to Thoothukudi GH. So now this time, pandemic time, I don't have a chance to go to the GH. So after all the issues, immediately a lot of newspaper they cover, and immediately this three district collector, Thoothukudi, Tirunelveli, Tengasi district collector, they pass the order. You can get the ART medicine for your nearby ART link offices. Okay. So immediately we provide the medicine and we get the medicine to door deliver that person.
Right.
So right. This kind of issues also there.
So I just want to open a question to all the panelists. That do you think that there are groups that exist now that everybody is on social media? Whether it's a WhatsApp group or on Facebook, where maybe, activists or artists or people from the community can share their concerns and, let's say, can also help each other out. So I don't know if Ejaz, you know, the issues that they face over there in Kashmir, are there ways for people from Tamil Nadu or any other part of India to also help and reach out to them? Or are the problems so great at each level that it's hard to come out of first what you are dealing with and maybe not be able to reach out to the other community?
We have the problems that this community is facing. The problems are similar throughout the South Asia. I mean, the problems are similar. Definitely, like, there is a possibility of collaboration. There's a possibility of more solidarity groups so that, you know, collective work is being done in order to, you know, not only to sensitize the larger communities, but also to work for the communities, to build the resources, to exchange the resources, to share the resources. It's very important to develop those, you know, those solidarity groups. I mean, this is a time of technology and the whole world is changing into a small village. And, you know, definitely, like, I mean, my work, you know, I share my work with the people in Tamil Nadu as well. I have friends in Hyderabad. I mean, we share our experiences. We learn from each other. I mean, the way they are expressing their desire to lead their movements, I'm learning from them. Though there are certain things which I cannot apply here, I mean, because of various barriers which are typical to the Kashmirs. Mm-hmm. But certain, like, there are many many things where we can learn from each other and we can share resources as well. Yeah.
And Kiruba, from the legal perspective, do you think that is there something that your initiative is doing to reach out to the community across India in terms of their rights and making them aware of the same?
Kiruba, before you answer, I just want to add another aspect to that.
Yeah.
The governmental schemes that are there, you can access them with your ration card or your other governmental ID cards. Which a lot of transgender people who have run away from home do not have access to. So how can the government kind of reach out to them, apart from, of course, NGOs and individuals otherwise? What can the government do to support them? Maybe you can add to that.
Yeah.
So my initiative is actually dealing with legal awareness for the lawyers, actually, because in the case of SCST atrocities, you can appoint a special public prosecutor of your own. Mm-hmm. But the prosecutor should have 7 years experience and he should know the in and outs of the special atrocities, I mean, Prevention of Atrocities Act. So we are basically training lawyers to have a better representation for the victims and the victims. And also when invited, we are going and, bringing awareness to the community. But as far as the LGBTQI community is concerned, I think the Tamil Nadu community is already well educated and they are the best groups in getting mobilized and getting educated. For instance, when the first protest against the transgender bill was came, it was from the Tamil Nadu community, and the kind of rationality they brought into the problems with the present transgender act was something insignificant. For instance, they were talking about how the not only the Transgender Protection Act but also the right new education policy and how the Anti-Human Trafficking Act would have an impact on the lives of transgender community. So I think when it comes to awareness and other things, Tamil Nadu is already doing its best, and many persons from the community are well educated and they have all the knowledge to educate themselves. That is one thing. And when it comes to state support and other things, like Sindhuja told, there are many people who have ration cards and they are able to access the government support schemes. But the Tamil Nadu government scheme is not as great as the Kerala scheme, because in Kerala, if you have a ration card, you have all the ration delivered into your home. Okay. Whereas in Tamil Nadu, they send amount to your bank accounts. And already Grace Bonu mentioned how many trans community does not have even
bank account, even ration cards. So if you can only access this basic ration with your ration card and your bank account, you won't be able to do. And I was with a friend, Kanaga Varadhan, who was also raising funds for our trans community since the lockdown. And when she was collaborating with the community, I was able to see many people, they don't even have access to digital devices like mobile phones, smartphones. They have basic phones. And even if you could have access for in banks and all, you don't have any immunity to go out to the ATM or to the banks. So the only privilege we all have is to check our internet banking and mobile banking. So there are many forms of inaccessibility in ensuring the protection of trans rights. I think it's taking different shapes and different levels. Organizations like Banus and there are many individuals here are trying to work it out.
Right. There's a question that I'd like maybe for you, Kiruba. Somebody's written to us saying that I identify as an agender person and go by they or them as pronouns. My question is regarding a report which is old. Has something been done to resist this move by government, or is it still in practice, which is transphobia? He has shared a link with us and his concerns are pretty much the same as Anindya Hajra, an activist with the Prate Gender Trust in Calcutta. I think maybe this is something, Kiruba, that you can take a look at and maybe respond to this person privately later.
Yes.
We'll have your email and maybe you can write to them.
Yes.
Separately.
Of course.
Since everybody cannot see the link. And there's one more thing, I think, that the community clearly is surviving through solidarity groups, non-profits in most cases. So whether it is Grace or whether it is your own non-profit that is working towards educating the lawyers, or it is certain journalists who are bringing up stories from the community. But ultimately, everybody needs a little bit of money to survive. And how can we support these organizations? I think Grace, as she mentioned, that she has recently done crowdfunding, and she has and she continues to do that. So does EJAS, and both these organizations have shared their details of their donation links and bank details with us, which are there on the Chennai Photo Biennale website as part of this event. Anybody who's interested in contributing a donation to help support the work that they are doing, please check out these details on our website. If you can't find them, please feel free to reach out to us at programming@ChennaiPhotoBiennale, and we will share that information with you again. I have one more question that has just come in, that from Anish Gawande. Trans rights have become the latest buzzword for governments across the world to prove that they are inclusive. The Indian government too has warmed up to the idea of promoting itself as an LGBTQ friendly on the world stage. The Trans Act is celebrated as an achievement. Revocation of Article 370 is made to look like a victory for gay rights. How do we respond to this?
Hello, Anish. I'm so happy you're here. Anish is a very close friend.
Okay, good.
Yeah. So, Anish, it's exactly like how we Dalits feel. You know what? We have a Prevention of Atrocities Act. We have every right on the paper. But in reality, we don't have any access to the right to education or right to employment. Even today, we have Rohit Vamla's committing suicide in the higher educational institutions. So 377 might be a legal success, but as a lawyer, I have already told it in many platforms and I'm reiterating it here. Justice for me is as in social justice, and it is not just legal justice. So we have so far achieved some level of legal justice through 377 judgment and also through NALSA judgment and through private privacy judgment. But still, when it comes to actual justice, it should be social. And for achieving social justice, we all need political commitment and political willingness to make it possible. So we are very far from achieving that kind of social justice that Dr. Ambedkar dreamt of. So, and also another thing is, when it comes to 377, we have been talking about how it has been legalized, but we are not talking about the practical impediments. For instance, I was supporting a couple belonging to a dominant caste in Tamil Nadu, and they have eloped from India to London in order to escape the violence that their community, the most dominant and the patriarchal community, should could commit against them. And you know what? They have sent goons in London from their own community to murder them. So the trans community people, while they are not able to escape such violences here, I have seen a gay couple who have tried to escape by eloping to London, but still they are having a threat to life. And the UK government is not recognizing it because India has already legally recognized gay rights. So yeah, it's the situation is very similar to even Muslims and Dalits here. It's and you're well aware of all these things, but I'm happy you asked it here.
Okay, great. Sindhu, do you have any pending questions? We are kind of already over time, but maybe if there is a question that you might want to close the panel with.
Not exactly a question. Couple of things that I missed. I was thinking of.
Sure.
One is, you know, when I was trying to raise funds, and there is this friend of mine, an acquaintance of mine, who was willing to give a huge amount of money to support. And I shared Banu's link about supporting transgender people. And his question was, hey, can I instead give for farmers rather than sex workers? It wasn't, and I think social inclusion, there was the whole stigma of supporting sex workers who are equally suffering. He said, no, but I'm okay to give farmers, but not sex workers. So I think that's kind of an instance of, you know, stigma, which is influencing how much we're able to support them right now.
And also, I think the question is that you are generalizing that each and every trans person is a sex worker. They might need to resort to it because of lack of other economic opportunities, but this generalization is so common. It's actually quite upsetting, but I guess it still continues, and that's where I think whether it's journalists or whether it is photographers and their portrayal also of the community, it really needs to start normalizing the debate and discourse here. Yeah, please continue.
Yeah, so that's the one thing. But I think another bit is about Banu's situation right now, where the owner of the houses that she lives in Thoothukudi and Chennai have been asking for rent. And when they were not willing to vacate, they cut off the water supply this morning. Banu, you can share better.
Yes. So the in Tamil Nadu government said, I think the house owners don't ask the rent, but for the ground level, yeah, reality is all the transgender persons we are living in the rental house. So our house owners definitely they are asking rent. So I got a call from my owner in Chennai house. She said, we send this month house rent bill. So I said, no, government put the order to don't ask the rent. No? So she said, no, ma, we don't have any chance. So you should pay the rent. So I said, okay, I will think. Right now I'm in Thoothukudi. I will speak with you directly when this issues finish now. So I cut the call immediately today. I'm in this Kovilpatti house now. So this house owner came came to us to pay the rent. So I said, no, because this is village. So I said, no, we don't have money. These people, they can't go anywhere. So we are struggling in the inside. And I told all the other things. But immediately they said, you should pay the rent. Otherwise, I will cut the water. So he cut the water.
Yeah, I would like to make a loss.
Ground level reality. So we should, whatever the way government order is passed, as a trans person, because we don't have any chance to have anywhere to get the rental house. So these people, these house owners, they are utilizing these opportunities. So if you can't pay the rent, you should leave from our home.
Yeah,
so how do we file? So yeah, okay, in case I file the case against that house owner, for approach the high court on anything, I got the order. Yeah, okay, but what are the reaction of other house owner when I move to other house? So that house owner, they can't give the house because your behavior like this. So they are scary.
So it's like a complete cycle of problems that starts, right? Kiruba, you were saying something.
Yeah. So when we ask for financial support for working class groups and trans groups, the one question that keeps coming is government is giving them money and government is giving the ration, and why should we support? And a few groups, they also ask that surviving this 1 month lockdown is the only thing that we have been concerned about. No, actually surviving after the lockdown is a very big deal for vulnerable communities like trans communities, working classes, daily wage laborers, and talents. Because this 1 month lockdown would have a long-term or long-time impact on the economical crisis, even nationally, and it's been well recognized that even the international community is going to have economical crashes. So at this point, I think, Sindhuja, we should actually tell our supporters or contributors that we also have another kind of responsibility in supporting the vulnerable communities after the lockdown, importantly, most importantly.
That's very well said, Kiruba. So I guess on that note, we will bring an end. Of course, there is always so much more to talk about. But I think the wonderful thing about having this discussion today is that it has brought all of us together, and at least we've been able to have a conversation on the issues that continue to exist, and how at least some of us are standing up and discussing it, fighting for the rights. And it's very important that this discussion continues. Thank you so much to all our panelists for their time and for sharing about their work. I also thank all the people who have attended this session today. As I mentioned earlier, that we have two donation meetings, one for the work that Grace is doing and one for the work that Dr. Ejaz is doing in Kashmir. We request you that please try and contribute something towards the efforts that they are putting in. It's the least we can do. The information is there on the Chennai Photo Biennale websites in the event section. We will also be sharing that on your emails. Thank you so much for being with us. And please do stay tuned with us. We do have more programs coming up very soon. Thank you, Sindhu, and each of the panelists for being with us.
Thank you, Sindhu. Bye, Banu.
Bye.
Follow us on Chennai Photo Biennale. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you all.